Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Islam Explained Theology Series Part 1. I am Veysel Gençoğlu. Today we have some interesting questions for our guest Ömer Ergir, who is a theologian and an author of 7 books. So let's begin. Welcome again, Ömer.
Thank you for the invitation, Brother Veysel.
Can you please tell us what does Islam offer for humanity?
What does Islam offer to humanity? It's a big question. I think fundamentally it offers humanity happiness and contentment, both in this world and in the one next. However, if we approach the issue from a theological perspective, we can say that Islam offers answers to most critical questions that have been put forward to humanity since the beginning of history. Now, all philosophers, thinking people have thought about questions such as, who am I? Where do I come from? What is my purpose in life? Where am I heading? And Islam answers all of these questions.
What if someone says, why should there be a purpose? What, do we really need to look for a purpose in life?
I think it'll be good to answer this question with an analogy, a little story, where two brothers are swimming in their private pools, and suddenly they vanish from this pool, and they find themselves on this strange alien planet. And initially, of course, they have fear, they are confused, but eventually they get used to their environments. And they begin to test various plantations and, of course, organic life forms of aliens to see whether they can survive on this planet. And gradually and eventually they realize that they are actually made for this new planet. And they feel like everything is serving them on this planet, and they are like kings on this planet. After a while, one of the brothers asks the other one a theological or philosophical question, we should say. He says, do you remember the time that we were swimming on our private pool? We vanished from there, and then we found ourselves on this strange planet, an alien planet. Should we not be asking ourselves, how did we get here? Who brought us here? What is our purpose on this planet? What is expected of us? Now, the other brother, he was more relaxed. He did not care about these sort of philosophical issues. And he said, what is the point asking these questions? We are here and that's it. Let us just enjoy ourselves. Now, if I were to put to you, which brother has a thinking which is more logical, more rational, obviously, you would say the first brother who is concerned or who wants to inquire how he got there. Now, we can take this example analogy and put it into reality. In reality, these two brothers are actually sperm cells swimming in a male semen. And as you know, this is the biological reality of this world, this life, that human beings, once upon a time, they were swimming in that pool, and then suddenly they vanish from that pool and they find themselves on this planet. And then when they first come to this planet, Earth, that we call Earth, they are confused, they are crying. All babies do the same thing. But as they get used to their environment, they realize that all the other creatures on this world, including the plantations and the animal kingdom, they say that there are about 8 million different species on Earth. And they all serve humanity, they all serve them, they all serve us. Now, logically, rationally, we should be asking ourselves, you know, what is our purpose here? How did we get here? Who put us on this world? And what is expected of us? And from this line of questioning, maybe we can work out the purpose of life too. Now, if we take this question and put it to Islam, Islam will say, yes, you do have a purpose. It was God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who took you away from that semen, that sperm, that pool, and placed you on this planet, and you are going through a certain test. And you do have a purpose in this life, and it's a higher purpose. It's higher than all the rest of the creation as well. So we can fundamentally say it was God who put us here, and we do have a purpose in life.
Okay. So some people say you cannot prove the existence of God scientifically. What do you say to this argument?
Now, I heard this argument a number of times as well. First of all, I think I should point out that the argument is missing an important premise. Because when they put this argument to you, they say that you cannot prove God's existence scientifically. They are missing a very important premise there, which is you cannot prove the existence of non-existence of God scientifically. That would be more of a valid argument there. Now, is the argument valid or not as an it is in its entirety? We have to look at it from a perspective of its validity, or is it logical to ask or to say that you cannot prove the existence or non-existence of God from a scientific perspective? If we are implying that God cannot be proven through a test in a lab, or a physical test, for example, from the perspective of physics, biology, whatever sciences that you are looking at it from, then the answer would be no, you cannot prove or disprove, because you cannot test the supernatural. It's impossible to test metaphysics. You can only test what exists within this physical world, within this physical universe. So from that perspective, the answer would be, yeah, it's a valid argument. However, if we put it through a philosophical perspective, maybe we can also add theoretical physics in there as well, then you would have to say proving the existence of God would be easier than disproving his existence, because it would be impossible to disprove the existence of God from a physical perspective. But it will be much easier to prove that he exists by using a number of valid arguments through philosophy and through physics as well.
Thank you, Amma, for those comments. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you next time.